This is Community Perspectives, and we're going to focus the next 10 minutes on the program this week on Albany. And, of course, a lot of big changes coming up in Albany in the next few weeks, including a new governor that will be taking office. Albany, a very interesting topic as always, and here to joining us to talk about what's going on and what their take is on what will happen in the next year. I want to say hello to Brian Sampson. He's the executive director of the organization Unshackle Upstate. Brian, thanks for joining us.
It's our pleasure, Nathan. Thanks for having us.
Before we talk about Albany, give people an idea, if they're not familiar with Unshackle Upstate, a little bit of history of the organization and what you guys are all about.
We were formed back in 2006 by the Upstate New York Chambers of Commerce to shed a light on the issues that Upstate New York has that are very different from a New York City economic base. And so what we try to do is educate elected officials about the legislative bills that they are considering, provide them alternative options on public policy that will benefit Upstate New York and taxpayers overall. And this past fall, we engaged in our first series of legislative scorecards. We've made a decision to endorse candidates for office at the Senate and Assembly levels and executed a plan this fall. So for us, it's a function of we want to be a loud, resounding voice for Upstate New York and do what's best for our businesses to create private sector job growth and lower the burden that we as New Yorkers face on a tax burden side.
And I think that's where the name Unshackle Upstate comes from. Obviously, your organization feels that Upstate New York is without a better word, I guess, or better term, being dragged down by a lot of decisions that are being made. Is it fair to say by the downstate region?
Well, I think what would be fair to say is that whether you're in Long Island, Westchester, or Upstate New York, we all battle a New York City political system that doesn't fundamentally understand how we operate our day-to-day lives, our businesses, our families, our homes. When you look at property taxes in New York State, people that live in New York City don't traditionally pay property taxes. Everything is funded through a personal tax system. So when we try to lower the property tax burden that we have here, and clearly people can read the studies, we have the highest property taxes in the country as a percentage of home value, they don't understand that because they don't deal with that. So our job is to make sure that the politics of New York City really do understand what we're faced with and how we can make it all better, because a vibrant upstate is good for downstate, and a vibrant downstate is good for upstate. We're not trying to say that we should get special treatment, but at the same time, we're all in this together, so let's figure out how we can change the system going forward.
We first spoke with you on this program last year, and certainly it was an interesting year in Albany. The dysfunction that has characterized the state capital for a while now just was on the stage for everyone to see. Since that time, we've had elections and a lot of changes. How pleased is the organization with what we saw in November, and even going back to the primaries in September? Do you think a message was sent to leaders in Albany?
Well, I think a very clear message was sent to all of the elected officials. And when you look at it from a statewide perspective, there are going to be over 35 freshman senators and assembly members heading to Albany in January. For New York State, that's a tremendous amount of new blood going into the legislature, people with new ideas, different ideas, people that we can work with to change systems going forward. For those incumbents that were reelected, I think overwhelmingly we saw their margin of victory to be quite significantly lower, which again is a message to them that they need to be more focused on what their constituents want and what we really need to survive. And from our perspective, this past fall, we made a decision to endorse 24 candidates for office. That included 11 incumbents, 13 challengers, of those 24, 18 of them won. Of those 18, I believe 7 of them were challengers. And the one race that we're most pleased with is the fact that Patty Ritchie, who's going to represent the North Country, is returning, or not is returning, but has been elected to represent the district in the Senate. And what that means is for us in upstate New York, the Senate has gone back, for all intents and purposes, to be Republican-controlled. What that means is upstate New York now has a greater voice and more influence because we have more Republican senators from our region than we do Democratic senators. So that's, from our perspective, a very good set of circumstances that we're hopefully going to take advantage of as we roll into 2011, look at our policy agenda and seeking the changes that we need. And then once again in 2012, we're going to have to turn around and do the election thing all over again. So we're very encouraged.
I remember the endorsement of Patty Ritchie heading into the election by Unshackle Upstate. What was it about her specifically that led your group to decide to give the backing to her as opposed to the Democratic incumbent, Daryl Oppertine?
Well, we operate from four core principles. That is that as an organization, we encourage elected officials not to support any budget or legislative bill that adds to state spending, that increases taxes and fees, that adds more unfunded mandates to the local government and school district, or does anything to add to our state debt. And when we looked at candidates for office this fall, we wanted the candidates that were that made a commitment to support those four core principles. In an instance of that race, while I think many of us had respect for Senator Oppertine and the work that he had done, unfortunately, there was a record there of supporting additional spending and taxes and fees, and that's something that goes against our core principles. Senator-elect Ritchie made a pledge to us that she would work with us to lower state spending, lower taxes and fees, reduce mandates, you know, and work on the state debt. Those 24 candidates all made that commitment to us. That's why they got our endorsement, and that's why we worked hard to get them elected.
And, of course, the big news was in statewide politics, the election of a new governor. Andrew Cuomo will be taking the reins of the governorship as of January 1st. What is your organization's take on the prospects of a Cuomo governorship?
Well, when you looked at Governor-elect Cuomo's campaign for office, and by the way, we're very encouraged. We're happy that he's won. We look forward to working with him. We think he's going to be a great representative for New York State. But when you looked at his campaign, many of the positions that he took aligned very nicely with what our organization has been talking about for the last 4 years, and that is that we are on a spending trajectory that needs to be dramatically reduced. We've added, you know, roughly 8% spending in the last 2 years, added $9.2 billion in new taxes and fees onto a group of citizens that have limited resources and limited means because our private sector job growth just hasn't existed. So we're encouraged by what we heard. We're very encouraged by what we see in the last few weeks since he's been elected. You know, our organization is working with his transition committees to make sure that we can tap into the right people in upstate New York to join that administration, people that will advocate for our issues and our concerns and will work with us to pass good public policy that, again, addresses our four core principles. But overall, we need to lower the burden on upstate taxpayers because we just simply can't afford what we're doing now. It all has to be fixed. Is it going to be a rough road? Absolutely. Are we going to see some services cut? Unfortunately, yes. But the reality is the fiscal situation demands that we make those changes. And our philosophy has been, let's make the changes quickly and get through the pain of them as opposed to extending them over the next few years. It just seems better to kind of nip it in the bud now and get them taken care of.
And certainly something to keep an eye on during the course of the year as far as what change, if any, that we'll see out of Albany. If people would like more information on your organization, probably the best place to start is the website. Give us that address and any other information that people may like to have to learn more about Unshackle Upstate and how they can get involved.
Sure. Our website is unshackleupstate.com, and we've also moved into the social media space because it is a growing opportunity for us to get in front of more New Yorkers. So if you're on Facebook, you can find us as Unshackle Upstate. If you're on Twitter and you like to do the tweets, you can find us at Unshackle New York. We also have a YouTube channel. You know, so we've created a place where people can come and get as much information about New York State, about the budget, about politics. We've provided them opportunity to leave comments, to get more information. But, you know, what this comes down to, Nathan, is the elections that we just went through a few weeks ago sent a very clear message to the elected officials headed to Albany that, listen, enough of the shenanigans, enough of the chatter. We need to fix what's wrong in New York State. We need to fix it soon. And the message that they sent was either be a part of the solution, or if you choose to be a part of the problem, you know, we don't have an issue anymore replacing our incumbent senators and assembly members who aren't making the tough decisions that benefit and support their constituents.
That's Brian Sampson. He is the executive director of Unshackle Upstate. Once again, their website, www.unshackleupstate.com. Brian, thanks for joining us on Community Perspectives.
It's always a pleasure, Nathan. Appreciate the time.